Alright, so in this video we're going to be deriving E equals mc squared using four vectors and special relativity. To understand this derivation, I'm expecting a base level knowledge of special relativity. Unfortunately, to derive the most famous equation in physics, we're going to need a little bit of background. So you should know that four position is a vector describing events in space-time. The inner product in Minkowski space puts a negative sign on the position coordinates, a hint of hyperbolic geometry. The terms space-time and proper time should be familiar to you, and of course, know what the gamma factor is. Alright, so let's just get on with it then. So to prove E equals mc squared, I'm going to actually have to prove the more general E squared equals mc squared squared plus pc squared equation. To do that, we're going to consider the only four vector we know about right now, which is four position, and we wonder, are there any other four vectors? Well, of course, if you multiply this four vector by a scalar invariant quantity, then your new vector will also satisfy the properties of a four vector. Note, I'm very suggestively using m here as my variable, because mass is an example of such a quantity. You can, of course, also add and subtract two four vectors to produce a new four vector. These operations by themselves don't really let you do anything that interesting, except, wait a second, derivatives, if you look at the definition, just involves subtracting vectors and dividing by a scalar, and a limit, but let's not talk about that. So if you want to go from our four position to a velocity, we should be able to take the time derivative of each term, right? Not so fast. The time being used in that derivative is totally frame dependent, and so this operation has a different effect depending on the frame of reference we choose to use. So what is a time that everyone agrees on? This is where proper time comes in, the space-time separation between two events along a world line in a stationary frame, with its dimensions fixed to be a time. This quantity that has dimensions of time can be used in our derivative just fine, so bear with me for a minute as we try using it. So we're defining four velocity as the proper time derivative of four position. We're going to go through simplifying each term one at a time, but quickly we're going to come upon this question, wait, what's dt by dtau? There are plenty of ways of getting to that answer, so leave one in the comments actually if you have another method to show, but here's one that I like. Let's take this definition of proper time and replace all the terms with differentials. Then we can just factor out the cdt squared term, and we get that d tau is the square root of 1 minus a bunch of terms times dt. Let's then realize that all those terms are actually just the magnitude of our speed squared. And so d tau is just the square root of 1 minus phi over c all squared times dt. With some light rearranging, dt by d tau is 1 over the square root of 1 minus phi over c squared, which is just gamma. So yes, very weird that we're taking the time derivative with respect to another time, but the fact that we end up with a useful physical quantity is a good sign that we're going in the right direction. So we've got the first term of our new four vector, but what about the rest? Consider the chain rule. Dx by d tau is just dx by dt times dt by d tau, and dx by dt is just the normal x component of velocity we know and love, and dt by d tau is gamma, as we just found out. Of course, a similar thing applies for all the other terms, and so we end up with this expression for our velocity four vector. So dy by d tau is going to be vy times gamma, and dz by d tau is going to be vz times gamma. It's understandably very weird, so maybe sit with it for a sec so that it all sinks in. From here, we need to move on to four momentum. Remember that our full relativistic energy equation had momentum in it. And luckily, moving on to momentum is as easy as multiplying by m. So now let's think about the properties of this four momentum vector. To begin with, let's consider its general inner product with itself. Okay, so we're going to just have to go through a bunch of working out here, but bear with me for a minute. So we're looking at this mess of algebra. What's our route to simplifying this? If we look at the spatial components, we could factor out gamma squared m squared, and so in the brackets we're just left with the sum of the squares of all the components of velocity. But that's just the magnitude of the velocity squared by Pythagoras, as actually we just used a moment ago. Then let's write out the gamma squared in its full form and put everything on a common denominator. With some careful factoring, we notice that we can cancel out the 1 minus v over c squared term on the numerator and denominator. This means that the inner product simplifies to mc squared, like all squared. So this leads to a few important conclusions. Firstly, this inner product is invariant. However, that really shouldn't be that surprising because all inner products in Minkowski space are invariant under a Lorentz transform. That's like the reason that they are useful. But what is interesting is that because this inner product always equals this constant, that means that the inner product is a conserved quantity as well, which makes it incredibly useful when solving problems. However, we are left with this little question, which is, what exactly does the time component of that four momentum exactly mean? I know as we look at this equation, it probably looks eerily close to our energy equation, and we are almost there, I swear, but we can't get ahead of ourselves. We first need to consider what this time component of momentum actually means. Can we assign it a physical meaning? So the time component is gamma mc. Let's expand that out into its full form and then write it as a negative power. Then let's think about what this formula reduces to at low speeds by binomially expanding it out and checking if it matches something we know from Newtonian mechanics. We find that the time component of momentum is approximately mc times 1 plus 1 half v squared over c squared. The negative sign cancelled because of the negative a half power that we have up top. If we expand that out, we get two terms. The first term, mc, doesn't really have an obvious link to Newtonian mechanics, but the 1 half mv squared over c looks exactly like kinetic energy divided by c, which gives us a hint that this component has something to do with energy. To really see this, let's just multiply and divide the component by c. We then find that gamma mc squared is approximately mc squared plus 1 half mv squared at low speeds. So it is this term that we're going to call our relativistic energy. In fact, this already shows why it makes sense to define the rest energy as E equals mc squared, as this is the energy associated with an object when its velocity is zero. But we're going to keep going until we reach the general energy equation as we wrap up everything we've been doing together. So we now know that the time component of momentum is E over c, and using our definition of four momentum, we can write an inner product. We also know that that inner product is always equal to a constant, and that we can replace the time component of it with E over C. Looking at this, we kind of want to get the E on its own, so let's just multiply both sides by C squared. Which leads to E squared minus gamma squared P squared C squared is equal to MC squared times C squared, which we can rewrite as MC squared all squared. Then let's just put the E squared on its own, and we have it. This is energy in Einstein's theory of special relativity. But maybe the astute among you are confused by the gamma showing up in this derivation. Nothing to worry about there, as that's simply because in the formula without the gamma, they're just making sure to use the magnitude of the momentum as measured in the frame of interest. So that's it. Thanks for watching. Be sure to check out some of my other videos. I also highly recommend Eigenchris's series on special relativity. It's a big inspiration for this one. So thanks again for watching, and bye-bye.